Okay, we're here today to have worship. It's really nice to see everyone here, even from Abu Dhabi and all the Gulf. It's always nice to see a lot of people in the church. Amen?
Amen.
Yeah, for right now, I know we have all our busy lives, but let us focus and direct our focus and our hearts right now in worshiping God. There's here. Come on! Make a joyful noise, come on!
Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. Serve the Lord, serve in gladness. Come before His presence with singing. Enter into His gates with thanksgiving. And His forts with praises. Be thankful, be thankful unto Him. And bless His holy name. Know ye that the Lord is God. It is He who hath made us, not we ourselves. We are His people and the sheep of His pasture.
Praise the Lord.
Yeah.
today. You know, I usually get nervous when we're speaking in front of this large crowd. But yeah, amen. Thank you so much, song leaders, for that wonderful song. But hi, for those who don't know me, my name is Vince. And it's a privilege for me to welcome you all to the ICOC Church Service, UAE. I would also like to welcome the Abu Dhabi people, okay, and other people from other Gulf region. And I would also like to welcome our visitors, Brother Maharaja, sorry, from India. Welcome. And also our sister Christy coming from Israel. Welcome. And we also have visitors coming from Zimbabwe. And from Fungai and Tariro. Okay. Welcome. And also, let's not forget to welcome the month of August. Yay! We already are in the 8th month of the year. Wow, can you believe that? Time flies so fast. And next month is gonna be what? Yeah, September, which means it's gonna be Burn month. So, advance, Happy New Year and Merry Christmas too. Especially for all those kabayan and Filipino. I hope all of you are ready for your Christmas lights and Christmas decorations. Okay. So next month, if you're gonna see Christmas lights from balconies, it's surely you will know that it's a Filipino family. Okay, so anyway, as part of my welcoming message, I want to share to you my favorite word in Bisaya. Okay, I want to share to you my favorite word in Bisaya. For those who don't know Bisaya, Bisaya is like a Philippine language. It's like part of the 120 languages in the Philippines. Yeah, I did research on that just to make sure. So one of my favorite words in Bisaya is the word puhon. Okay, puhon. When you spell it, it's gonna be P-U-H-O-N. Puhon. Can everybody say it?
Puhon.
Puhon. Okay, congratulations, all of you are resigned. I should maybe switch to Risa in my course. But anyway, so the reason why it's my favorite word, because for me it sounds hopeful, okay? It's, puhon is an expression that Bisaya people usually use whenever we want to be hopeful or whenever we are hopeful. So let's use the word puhon in a sentence, okay? Puhon. Things will be okay. Puhon, I will find a job. And puhon, God will answer my prayer. And another scenario will be, if someone will tell you, hey brother, hey sister, I wish you success, then you should respond the word puhon. Okay? So, yeah. But I want to share this word with you because it carries this beautiful sense of hope and faith, okay? And as we begin our service today, I want us to embrace this hopeful heart, okay? Embracing this hopeful heart. Let's have a heart full of hope in God, trusting that He will answer all of our prayers and He will help us through our struggles, amen? And, you know, even some of our prayers haven't been answered yet. This word poem reminds us that to keep our faith alive, it encourages us to trust in God's perfect timing, okay? So this word tells us that there is hope even in the waiting, okay? And that God's plans are always for our good, okay? So when we go to Psalm 37 verse 5, it says here, commit your way to the Lord, trust in Him, and He will do this, amen. So as we gather here today, let's keep this hope in our hearts. Let's keep the trust that God hears us, hears our prayers. And again, thank you all so much for being here. Let's get ready to worship together, full of hope in our hearts and trust and faith. And puhon, my brothers and sisters, things will be okay.
Amen.
So, for our lineup for today, Brother Robert and Glory will take us to the foot of the cross. And our Kuya Andrew. Kuya Andrew will do the main message. And Angelo will be the closing response and announcement. So let's get all excited for this lineup and let's go to God in prayer. Dear God, our Heavenly Father, We thank you for this day, for this another day of hope, another day of blessings of knowing you, Father, another day of opportunity of hearing your words that give us hope, your words that give us strength every single day as we continue to fight our struggles. Dear God, our Father, continue to shower us with this strength. Continue to shower us with the words full of hope. Because, Father, without you, we are nothing. Yeah. We thank you for the service, Father, and may you bless all the speakers today. We love you, and this we ask through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Prepare our hearts for the communion.
From the Lord what I also pass on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you, to do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this with it whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." For whatever you eat, this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. You know, in today's fast-paced world, like living in Dubai, it's easy to become consumed by work and neglect other important aspects of our life, which is health and family. You know, maintaining a health work-life balance is essential for overall well-being, but also a challenge. Most of us experience burnout, stress, poor mental and physical health. I think I believe when you are in UAE, that's a typical normal, right? But for me, I remember when I started working at the age of 16 years old, and just to support myself. And I grew up without my parents. You know, I worked in different fast food and restaurant in the Philippines just to support myself. I remember I started work in abroad way back 2006. Most of the, especially friends that know that I'm working in KFC. You know, I started in KFC, go to different restaurants, transfer to hotel, and now I'm current, you know, handling multi-brand restaurants in Kitopi as a senior brand chef. I have more than 10 brands with me, and from UAE and GCC country. From my humble beginning, you know, I'm grateful for where I am now. For those who working in the same field as mine, you know, will understand the challenge and the amount of stress we have to handle. And it's not easy stress to take all toll on my body. And like misplacing things, forgetting the dates, having trouble recalling the names, you know, especially when you're getting older, you know, and especially driving in six-sided road, and the car just stopped in the middle of the road, in the almost in the noontime of this summer. And guess what? I forgot to put the petrol. you know, that's stressful because I need to, you know, turn off the car and wait for cop to arrive and praying deeply that no one will gonna hit my car at the back. So I have been hospitalized 5 times due to stress or for not taking time to pause. You know, as I face these struggles, I learn to accept my limitation and the things that I can't control. Mm-hmm. And remembering the hardships I've been through, I am grateful for the learnings. Now remember Jesus on the cross. Remember all the sacrifices is done for me. Remembering 27 years ago that I decided to be baptized and follow Jesus. I will forever be grateful. I'll let my wife to share as well.
Amen. It says forgetfulness is a normal part of aging. As we grow older, our memory lapses. But no matter what our age is, it's easy to get lost in the busyness of this world. This world just pushes us towards work. Work hard, work harder and harder. But no matter how hard we work, it's never enough. In reality, we are actually living our lives in a rat race, running from activity to activity, meeting our daily needs. An endless pursuit of success, happiness, satisfaction, and validation from this world. Time flies too fast, and we need to realize that every moment of our life is a gift from God. From my experience, if I don't feel I have enough time in my day, one of two things is true. I'm either trying to do too much, or I'm wasting time on the things that are not really important. I've learned the truth that life is really short. We actually have just enough time to do God's will. And we all need to hear and believe that only one thing is needed. It's Jesus. When I look back, I have regrets for the time I have wasted. But everything changes when I realize that we have a Savior who gave everything up for us. He loved and still loves us that much. In Him, there is still hope. The truth of Christ's death and resurrection should stay with us all, every single day. Strengthening us, humbling us, encouraging us, and motivating us to keep all things in the right perspective. Today, at this very moment, let us all take the time to pause, to take a step back, re-evaluate, and truly remember what is really important, and to let the truths of Jesus' love sink in our hearts, that no matter what we're dealing with, no matter how stressed we are right now, no matter how hard the world pushes us into our limits, our Lord Jesus Christ already overcome the world. Our past, our present, and even our future were already covered by the blood of our Lord Savior Jesus Christ. Amen.
Brothers, sisters, when we take the communion, we are reminded that what Jesus did for us on the cross. And it should not be not an empty ritual for us to do just because we had to. Let us practice communion to help us remember so we can be grateful again. Let us pray. Dear God, we are grateful here today to celebrate the sacrifice of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died on the cross to cleanse us from our sins. We thank you for the gift of forgiveness and opportunity to come to your table and partake in communion. Bless the bread and wine. May we never forget the incredible love and grace that you have shown us through Christ. And we may always strive to follow his example of selflessness and service to others. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
You are.
didn't see each other. 3 weeks or two weeks, yeah? So what's the... I'm so unfit, yeah. Anyway, what's the update? This is the update for me. Twice this month, I got this message from RTA. Failing is not the end of the world. Anybody receive this?
No?
This is how many times when you fail your driving test. So I failed twice already. So yes, we will try again. I'm taking manual gear. Yeah, so. Okay, so that's the update. I hope all you guys are well. By the way, it's been very, very blessed, a worship service for me. I am fully blessed already with all the singings, the beautiful lyrics, and just the sheer enjoyment of knowing that I'm singing together with everybody who shares the same faith. It's so empowering, yeah? So we praise God, and let's go to our Father in prayer. Oh God, you are the everlasting God. You do not faint, you do not grow weary, but God, we lose our steps, we lose the springs in our feet, even as we get older, but God, our hope is in you. God, who are we that we should be handpicked by you to pause from whatever we're doing outside so that we could be here and listen to you and offer you worship that you deserve and more. And in so doing, we are the ones who will be fully blessed. You are a gracious God. You are a great Father. We praise you. We honor you. Be with me as I lead the discussion of your word today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Yeah, so let's open up our Bibles to Mark 6. Yeah, okay. Mark 6, 14 to 29. Herod had John the Baptist beheaded. And that was also the time when Jesus was becoming well known. He was preaching, calling people to repent, just like John the Baptist. Is that what we're reading? Are we reading the same thing? Oh, King Herod heard about Jesus, that Jesus had become well known. Some were saying John the Baptist has been raised from the dead, and that is why miraculous powers are at work in him. Others said, no, he is Elijah, and still others claimed he is a prophet, like one of the prophets of long ago. But when Herod heard this, he said, John, whom I beheaded, has been raised from the dead. For Herod himself had given orders to have John arrested, and he had him bound and put in prison. He did this because of Herodias, his brother Philip's wife, whom he had married. For John had been saying to Herod, it's not lawful for you to have your brother's wife. So Herodias nursed a grudge against John and wanted to kill him. But she was not able to because Herod feared John and protected him, knowing him to be a righteous and holy man. When Herod heard John, he was greatly puzzled, yet he liked to listen to him. Finally, the opportune time came. On his birthday, Herod gave a banquet for his officials and military commanders and the leading men of Galilee. When the daughter of Herodias came in and danced, she pleased Herod and his dinner guests. The king said to the girl, ask me for anything you want, and I'll give it to you. Wow, she must be a great dancer. And he promised her with an oath, whatever you ask, I will give you up to half of my kingdom. She went out and said to her mother, what shall I ask for? The head of John the Baptist, she answered. At once the girl hurried into the king with the request, I want you to give me right now the head of John the Baptist on a platter. The king was greatly distressed. Okay? But because of his oaths and his dinner guests, he did not want to refuse her, so he immediately sent an executioner with orders to bring John's head. The man went, beheaded John in the prison, and brought back his head on a platter. He presented it to the girl, and she gave it to her mother. On hearing of this, John's disciples came and took his body and laid it in a tomb. Yeah. Very, very sad story. But, you know, in this passage, we have several characters. We have John the Baptist, who had just been beheaded. Okay, and then we have the teenage daughter of Herodias, who was such a fabulous dancer, must be. Right, but I should also say a young girl without a conscience. Very young, teenage girl without a conscience. Who's a teenager here? Imagine a teenager asking for a head of someone else. Yeah. Herodias, and then we have Herodias, the embittered mistress who resented John the Baptist because John the Baptist spoke negatively of what she did, right? And you can just imagine that. Do you ever like somebody who has a negative thing to say about you? And I think even the most saintly among us, if you have heard of another brother saying something negative, maybe you will not say much, but I think you will avoid in the fellowship, right? Just out of, you know, bitterness. But here you have a strong and powerful woman, Herodias. And she won't take it sitting down. Right? If you have the power, what you will do, you will try to scheme and wait for the time to eliminate your opponent. And that's exactly what she did. Then we have Herod, the very, very bright picture of ambivalence. He's the kind of person who was very conflicted. He feared John the Baptist, he respected him, he loved listening to John the Baptist, yet he was fooled more, you know, by the evil desires of his heart. In the end, you know, when you have a character like that, when push comes to shove, that kind of a character will always side with evil. So, you know, here it is pretty much the very picture of the average man. He will try to have connection with the divine, right, while enjoying the benefits of sin. Where am I going with this illustration? You know, there is a sizable portion of the population of the world who up to now acknowledges that Christianity has contributed much to civilization. You need to be blind. One needs to be blind to deny that the civilization has progressed to where it is today because of Christianity. The most productive scientists in the world at the turn of the 18th century, 17th century, are Christians. Hospitals got into existence because of Christians. Orphanages, because of Christians. Women's rights progressed because of Christianity. Yet, we live also in a world where the loudest voices now teach that the babies in the womb are not human beings, and you could kill them, and any mothers can so decide to kill that baby in the womb. They have the loud voice now teaching that there are 70 genders or more, and they're increasing every time. And they decree that God has no room in any social conversation. So don't ever bring up God in any social conversation. They espouse that freedom is the highest good, not God. They assault the Christian values. Their belief is clear. Christianity, if not stopped, or at least if Christianity will not adjust its values, Christianity will hinder the progress of civilization. And there, of course, these are the Herodias of the world today. They are the people who are bitter against Christianity, who they believe, Christians who they believe will hinder their agenda in achieving greater progress. So they will silence the Christian as much as possible. The agenda of the liberals and the woke, you have heard of the word woke? The woke mob are akin to Herodias' daughter dancing talent. You know, their agendas are the opportunities to demolish the John the Baptist of today, which are the Christians of today. And there are plenty of Herods, of course, politicians who try to please the conservatives. Now, it's the U.S. election, right? All the candidates, whether they're congressman or senator or president, they will make sure that in their CV they will put, "I was raised in a Christian background." Because up till now, 63% of U.S. population, you know, still write that they have a Christian background. So that's a very, very important thing. And yet, deep inside, many of these people are enemies of the Christian faith. You know? In the end, all these characters will side with evil. And of course, there's the Christian, who in the story is just like John the Baptist, who must be silenced. You know, in the wake, I don't know if you watched the Paris Olympic ceremony, anybody cared to watch? At least you saw in the paper what happened the day after. In the wake of the recent controversy over the alleged mockery or desecration of the Last Supper at the Paris Olympics, maybe we can play that just very, very briefly. And you can skip ad if there's an ad. Can we play it? After the opening ceremony, there's a backlash you know, on this. Is it gonna play? If it's not gonna play, just show the next slide. Is that one? Okay, just play it. For those who's not, this is just 1 minute, yeah. This is the Paris Olympics, about athletes, about sports, and yet look at what they did. It's okay if there's no sound. So these are all drags, transgender. And how do they look like? They look like the... Okay, so this... Stop it, can you stop it? Yeah. So this looks like, you know, a mockery, at least what people, how people perceived it. You know, we ought to understand the outrage of the Christians. Because today we just had our communion. It's so holy for us. No, like when Gloria and Robert were sharing how busy life could be, I was like, yeah, I'm really, really so busy. But I'm so happy that there is a moment like this.
Amen.
You know, when you can declutter and just say, not the thing is important, this is important. Mm. Right?
Yeah.
And you know, and what event was Jesus talking about? The Last Supper, right? You know, I think it's beneficial that we understand the outrage of the Christian world. And also to listen to the defense of the opposite side. You know, I say it's beneficial to discuss this and not just push it aside, because you cannot just say this doesn't affect us. The pollution in the Northern Hemisphere affects the Southern Hemisphere. It's just a matter of time, right? So there have been many who came forward to explain what happened. They said, if you go to the next slide, that it was not really about the Last Supper. It was about the depiction of a pagan celebration called the Feast of the Gods, with the god Dionysus. The semi-naked man is the god Dionysus, the god of wine and ecstasy, who's sitting there in the middle. I mean, okay. At the very least, I think it's tasteless. If they're telling the truth, I said, okay, well and good, but I think it's still tasteless for an Olympic ceremony to have this. No joke. And they claim it was not a mockery. It was meant to express France's commitment of inclusion. Everybody should be included, including the transgender and the drag queens. So for the sake of the unity of the world, let's give them the spotlight. Okay, so that's the explanation. It was supposed to be a call for progress. And of course, the LGBTQ community said, actually, that's not even enough. If you watch that, they danced first provocatively before they sat at the dinner table, right? So my personal view is this: although the Olympics committee was saying that it's a mimic of a pagan celebration at the Last Supper, I think the way the seating arrangement was done, you know,
yeah,
it's a bit suspect. I don't make my conclusion. I personally think it was disrespectful, and I say very tasteless at the very, very least. But there's just so much outrage in Christendom. And I think that the rational reaction should have been not surprised. Rather than surprised, what did you expect? Right? The world's rejection of Christianity in modern times, see, insurance is calling me on a Sunday. The world's rejection of Christianity in modern times has been rapid since the last century. At the turn of the last century, more so in the 1960s. You know, if you're like maybe Basamo who noticed that, you know.
Is that true? Yeah, right?
Yeah, correct, right? And by the turn of the 21st century, the decline of Christianity gained even more speed. So this sort of mockery is to be expected. Yeah? You know, we have been under fire for a long, 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 long time. You know, in Europe, the only trace of Christianity there are the cathedrals that are empty. If you have toured Europe, the cathedrals are empty. They are only museums and tourist spots, right? That's the only visible sign of Christianity. And pretty much Europe takes pride in being godless. The European Union takes pride in, we have our moral value. And you wonder, where do you get your moral value? Who taught you that moral value, right? and that they take pride in their human rights, the fight for human rights, but they have no source. If somebody has no source to get that stability from, what will happen in the end if it's shaken? You know, but there's a remnant voice in European circles that are pushing the debate to respect the Christian roots of Europe. Because anyway, if they trace back their ancestries, all their forefathers were baptized in the faith. You know, in fact, if you go, at least 20 countries in Europe have the cross in the flags, have the Christian cross. So it's hard for them to erase that background. If I go to the U.S., which was predominantly before a Protestant country, where the presidents would take their oath on the Bible, right, as they take office, and where faith in the Creator was obvious in their Pledge of Allegiance, one nation under God, right? Now that nation is the center of wokeness, okay? Which means it's a center for pro-abortion agenda, LGBTQ, gender identity, and race matters agenda like Black Lives Matter. The progress of this agenda, if you take statistics, are inversely proportional to the decline of Christianity in the U.S. As Christianity declines, the progress of this agenda goes up. Yes? And the more people reject and depart from Christianity, the more this agenda are advanced. In other words, given the pushback against Christianity in the Western world, the demise of the churches, the extreme popularity of atheism and secularism, why would that kind of a tasteless mimic of a pagan celebration or maybe Last Supper, or whatever you believe, why would that be a shock to us, right? You know, if my neighbor has been giving me a cold shoulder or raising her eyebrows when I pass by, it's only a matter of time when she will shout at me, right? I should not be surprised. So, brothers and sisters, maybe the only surprising for me is, wow, wokeness has even overtaken the Olympics. It's about, you know, sports. And yet that's how it's happening. You know, the U.S. Congress is close to being overtaken by wokeness. The EU insurance. Okay, sorry. The EU is the same. You know who's resisting? The African Congress. Kudos to the Africans. The Africans are saying you cannot dictate to us what is right or wrong. Right? The Southeast Asia is showing signs of cracking, of giving in, especially the Philippines, right? India is resisting.
Philippines and Southeast Asia are
brother. Yes, Southeast Asia. But we love India. We have a solid rock to hold on to. If the nations give up their Christian values without a solid rock to hold on to, how long do you think can they resist? When poor nations are told by the West, change your laws to accommodate wokeness, or you don't receive loans, how long can they resist? You know, brothers and sisters, these people are not Christians. Yeah? So we should not be surprised. The French government has nothing to do with Christianity. The Olympics Committee are not made up of Christians. So it surely hurts our feelings, but they are free to do what they want. Right? But we should not be afraid to express, you know, if we feel disrespected, but it stops there. No one is forcing you to watch the Olympics, and no one is forcing you to visit friends, okay? But to many Christians who can't accept what happened, I will really say this, are you kidding me? 2,000 years ago, thousands of Christians were crucified on crosses and tortured in the arena for their faith and Christian values. What do you expect? Are you kidding me? Our own Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, the world tortured and crucified our Lord and Savior. What do we expect? We have been so used to being dominant in this world for many, many years. But that is fading away. We should be ready for persecutions. John 7:7. our Lord and Savior, speaking to his physical brother, said this: "The world cannot hate you." He's talking to his brothers who are not his followers. "But it hates me because I testify that what it does is evil." When will the world hate you? When you tell them you are wrong. Could it be that the reason we're still not persecuted is because we're not telling them they're wrong? In John 15, he now speaks to his disciples, "If the world hates you, you know that it has hated me first before it hated you. If you were of the world will love you as its own." At the very end, "Remember the word that I said to you, a servant is not greater than his master. If they persecuted me, they will also persecute you." You know, my goal today is to help us pause and ponder, because if we don't, more cases like this will happen. And if we don't prepare now and prepare our minds, we will be unprepared when we are confronted. But if there's any cue you can pick from what transpired at the Paris Olympic ceremony, this: the world is bolder now in upholding perversion. You know, people can sin, but people hide their sin and, right? And are ashamed. But no, not anymore. They want the spotlight now. They have been emboldened by politicians who need their votes. So the world is so bold now in upholding perversion, what? In the veil of liberty, freedom, and justice. They already hijacked the rainbow, which is a symbol of God's faithfulness, right? Yeah. Of a promise. They hijacked it. And now they're hijacking liberty, freedom, and justice. They're putting a dark shadow of what these words mean. These words now mean that give everyone the right to do evil. You know, in all likelihood, brothers and sisters, the forces of darkness will continue to expand because they have found support among politicians, right? And of course, this is what gives them wings: political correctness. And I think even in the church, you may or may not admit it, you are very fearful to speak because you're afraid to hurt people's feelings. This political correctness has increased the power of the liberals and the progressives because they know they will be unopposed. You know, it's a case of darkness attacking light. But you know, brothers and sisters, you know that the ultimate victor always is the light. Yes. You know, in physics, there's no such thing as darkness. There's no such thing as darkness in science, right? It's a case of more or less light. You measure the amount of light. If it's almost zero, then it's dark. In other words, it's the absence of light which makes us perceive darkness. The more the world rejects Christianity and silence the Christians, the more light will fade in the world. And then darkness will cover more and more of the earth. Do you understand your value? Do you understand now why Jesus said we are the light of the world? If we Christians are careless and we allow our lamps to run out of oil, people around us will have no hope of seeing the light. Let's just see how much dark it has been. In the U.S. alone, I don't have a statistic. In the U.S. alone, I mean, we had Srikant. I think Srikant was very open about it. And Joy, they lost their baby, right? Did you see the pain of Joy when she was here? How old was that baby? Maybe 1 month old, right? She was in pain. And she's like, through the weeks that followed, she was bearing that. In the U.S., 1,026,000 babies were aborted. And this is just the official abortion that happened in officially accredited clinics. What about those that just take pills because their friends gave them? You see how evil the world is? Can you show the next slide? And this is a church, United Church of Christ. I mean, if you go back 60 years, we were together. before we all split as Church of Christ. They pass a resolution. They pass it with 611 in favor, 24 against, 13 abstaining. The right of all people to access reproductive health care, which means abortion, including contraception and abortion. We proclaim that forced birth is an act of sexual violence. And the choice to have and care for children is a sacred decision which should not be forced upon anyone. Church. It's the church. Look at the explanation. The UCC is a denomination founded on the principles of covenant and autonomy. He invited those voting to consider the ways they are touched by reproductive health care, either for themselves or in relationship to someone they love. It used to be that the argument for abortion is that the mother's life is in danger, right? Right? Or, and then it becomes the baby was a result of rape. And then it becomes, we can't afford to feed this baby. We can't imagine being constrained by taking care of this baby's needs. And what's the argument now? We have the right to decide what we do with our body. See? What about this one? In Europe, as Europe gets darker and darker without Christianity, the assisted suicide rate is growing. Assisted suicide means, I think I need to die now. Because anyway, you know, I don't think I will be healed. I think I have mental health issue. What about in Canada? Look at what they celebrated in 2018. They need to accommodate. They hate masculinity because men are controlling the women, right? Fight for feminism. In their national anthem, there's a word, in all of thy sons. Sons, meaning men. You know, but where did woman come from? From men. So when we say mankind, it's everyone, right? They hated that. So in the Senate, they passed a legislation to remove the word thy sons and replace it with gender neutral us. And you know what's their next target? To remove the word God in the national anthem. But they're having a hard time because how many gods are there? Number one, number two, ruler supreme is God. Help us to find, oh God, in love, as waiting for the better day. That's the resurrection. That's a lot of things to change. But they will get there. They will get there. You know, brothers and sisters, what about this? So many of them are being burned. What about this? Chris and Debbie sent this to me. Boy Scouts finally changed their name. Boy Scouts America changed their name to Scouting America to accommodate inclusive membership. Which means you don't need to be a boy to join the Boy Scout, okay? Boy Scout, they changed it. After 114 years. Do you see the pressure? Okay, next one. This student was taking Christianity class. Christianity, the subject was Christianity. Okay? And the teacher disagreed when he said there are two genders. He was ejected from class. Another one. This was a shot, of course, of the teacher, but kicking out his class also. This was in Europe. In Ireland, there are only two genders. In Scotland, sorry. Let's continue. Middle school in the U.S. This is what they're promoting. Sending your kids to U.S. Okay, next one. Let's make it younger. Huh? 10 years old, 6 years old. Okay? Let's make it younger. Kindergarten.
That's true.
You know, brothers and sisters, this is what's going to happen because in the U.S. there's a petition to remove In God We Trust in their coins. And there's a move to remove the Bible as the book where presidents will pledge.
Amen.
You know, brothers and sisters, the wind of change, and of course churches in Europe are being converted, in the U.S. are converted into homes you can buy and earn. It's a good real estate now, a good business. You know, brothers, it's the wind of change. And don't think it's not blowing on you. You know, I read that one of the most, sorry, fellow brothers, Indians, I heard Delhi is so polluted that the expectancy life of people there for inhaling the pollution is 12 years less. Can you avoid inhaling the air where you live? So when the winds of change are blowing, don't think it's not blowing on you and you're not inhaling. So the purpose of my discussion with you today is to ask you, have you evaluated how much of this air you have breathed in and accommodated? You know, even rocks, you know, when you see big rocks, you know, by the beach, it may take thousands of years, but the waves will continue to, and it shapes,
yeah.
Right? So don't think that you're hearing a lot about wokeness agenda, gender neutral, right? Respect for feminism, that it's not coming into your mind. If you're not careful to exhale them, it's creating something in your mind and you don't even know it. Do you think people with respiratory diseases are very aware of how much they have inhaled until such time that they have symptoms and they realize, that's how much pollution I have inhaled? You know, brothers and sisters, Proverbs 27 verse 3, as a man thinks, so is he, right? If you go back, once your mind is converted, you will become that person, right? And we are not any different from little children. Whatever we hear, we pick up. Songs you don't need to memorize in order to know, because you keep hearing it when you ride public transport or when you turn on the radio, you start to sway with it. Bro, I don't sing it, but every time you sway with it, right? Are we swaying? You know, I'm not saying we're guilty, I'm just saying it's time to evaluate. You know, brothers and sisters, many well-meaning Christians have lost their way because they're not wise to check if they're still standing on the truth. They start by being very respectful, right? We need to respect people's belief. But overly respectful, they feel compelled that overly respecting somebody can make you feel compelled to stay quiet, right? Because you will hurt someone's feelings. And then being quiet for a long time, you slide down the path of understanding. Now I understand what they're going through. Oh, that's why, right? And then that accepting turned into believing. And then embracing. And then they start to say, wow, I'm enlightened. I finally awakened. I'm woke now. Guys, members of ICOC, you watch what they post. We have some members who are already woke. But they didn't start like that. And then some take it a notch higher. They will promote it. And if you don't support them, they will unfriend.
Unfriend.
Sorry, I don't use social media. Most of our Christian conversions have this pattern. We were the same before we became Christian, right? We respected the church service. We tried to understand, accept, embrace until we are converted. We can be the conversion back to paganism will be the same. You inhale the air and you will be like that. You know, brothers and sisters, take this for example. Let's say you're concerned about the divorce rates happening in the world, right? Okay. And then you post on social media, Malachi 2:16, God says, I hate divorce. And it's not even your word, it's the word of the Bible. Are you ready for the backlash? Imagine some possible replies. What would be the possible replies? Kathy, who are you to lecture me? Right? Are you in a bad marriage like I am? Or maybe somebody will write, Kathy, wait till your husband cheats on you.
Yeah, thank you.
Right? Do you understand? Are you ready for such? Are you ready for such a battle? The only the only reply you want to receive on your wall, right, are positive, that will put you in a good light. What, let's say you're concerned about how many children are being raised by single parents, right? Not the ideal thing. We have many wonderful single moms by the grace of God. And God is their husband, and God has been gracious to them. But you post on social media how beautiful it is if all the children are born to married parents who intend to stay married. Is there anything wrong with that?
No.
It's a good wish, right? It's a good aspiration. Are you ready for a backslash? I know you are. When we were in college, you were the most immoral person. You don't even know how many illegitimate children you have walking in the town. Right? Arun, since when did you become a priest, right? Or maybe somebody would say, Arun, I did not expect this from you. You don't know how much you have hurt the feelings, my feelings, and the many single moms like myself. Are you ready for that? You know, so I say, and no one among us has perfect past. I mean, we confess in the church, you know, I was sinful, I was a murderer, blah, 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 blah. But you don't want the world to, like, you know, yes, I was a homosexual when I was 7 years old, and then I transitioned. You don't, this is not the business of the world to know. And see, our fear to be attacked hijacks us. It hijacks our opportunity, our desire to post something positive. Right? So while the woke mob are busy flooding social media with indoctrination and our children are reading them, we are busy posting what we ate last dinner time, right? Or how awesome Blue Waters is, and we take selfies. Actually, very few Christians even post scriptures now, if you notice. Right? Why? Fear? We fear developing enemies. It's real. We had a discussion in our Bible talk on the same topic. And disciples and members of our Bible talk admit, yes, I tried one time to talk to an office mate and the relationship was not the same. Right? But the Bible says, do not fear what they fear. Right? Do not be frightened. God knows we will fear. That's why he says, do not. You know, that's what it means. He knows we will fear. It's natural to fear. But says, do not be frightened.
Yeah.
Because he will be with us. And you know, another thing is apathy, right? I don't really care. I'm not involved. But remember the situation before with Mordecai. When the Jewish people were in danger of being eradicated. It says, for if you keep silent at this time, relief and deliverance will rise for the Jews from another place. But you and your father's house will perish, and who knows whether you have not come to the kingdom for such a time as this. God will win anyway. You know that, right? It's a secret. And you want to be part of that. But we can be apathetic. No, I'd rather be quiet. Can you imagine if Esther was quiet? And he said, I'll just be quiet here in the kingdom. In the palace. You know, we discussed this with our Bible. I said, okay, we can keep quiet. But our children will remember my father and mother were quiet. My auntie Kathy did not say anything. Even my Tito Srikan was quiet. And you know when they're quiet? How do children interpret that? Acceptance. That's why I admire these parents in the U.S. who will go to the school and just say, stop teaching my children this. And they allow their children to see that they're fighting. They're pushing back. And this will be in the mind of their children. But if we are quiet, we have many children in the kids' kingdom. You know, here in Dubai, one of the parents told me, no, Andrew, you also came from that school, right? Because we moved to a different school. You know, their teacher, year one, they said, we're teaching my boy that there are more than two genders.
No.
Peter, Peter, can you believe that? So she's moving to GEMS. Go GEMS. Because the international schools have more leeway with their... You know, that's why we can only admire those non-Christians who push back. Look at this. You know, this guy is a convicted criminal. You know, he's a famous football player. But he doesn't care what people will tell him. He says, why do trans men want to use women's toilets and invade women's space? If they don't want to use the men's bogs, then surely they can just use the disabled toilets. When I was a kid, a transvestite was considered a mentally ill man. A lot has changed, I know, but don't expect us all to play along with your delusions. I have no problem with you being trans, absolutely zero. Dress how you want, wear what you want, kiss what you want. I will never respect you as a woman. There are only two genders, male and female. Of course, he got the backlash. But his kids will know the truth. What about this one? Not a Christian. After the Paris Olympic ceremony, this is what he posted. Unless there is more bravery to stand up for what is fair and right, Christianity will perish. How can he read that and we cannot? You know, maybe you're torn between compassion and tolerance. Anyway, I can see Basam already signaling me. Okay, let's move. Let's move to, how do you face this? Number one, acknowledge the signs of the times. Go back. Yeah? Acknowledge the signs of that. There will be terrible times in the last days. Yeah. And you need to watch as it happens and just say, no, it's not the Dubai Shopping Festival. Right? If the Dubai Shopping Festival comes, it's the seasons, you know, shopping, blah, 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 blah. You get lost on that and you forget, wow, what are the signs of the times that are happening? It's the last days. We need to acknowledge that first. And when you know that it's the signs of the times, actually you're like, okay, God is right. He's in charge. He knows what's happening. I'm not surprised because it's written. Do you understand the difference? It's prophesied, right? The next one, trust in God's words. All men are like grass, and all their glory is like the flowers of the field. These people who are fighting God are grass. We are grass, they are grass. The grass withers and the flowers fall, but the word of the Lord stands forever. I did not even think that before I was a father, that I would do this regularly with my children. I tell my children, who created us? God. Whom did God create? Man and woman. There are only two. Can you believe that? Basam, did you teach your children this? Did you have to teach them? This is natural, but the truth is under attack, that the truth is being pushed away. But of course, you can never, never really succeed against the truth. You know, trust in the Lord. Stand as one. It's very important that we fellowship, right? Whatever happens, conduct yourselves in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ, that whether I come or see you or only hear about you, I will know that you stand firm in one spirit, contending as one man for the faith. And then that will be the proof that they will lose and we will win. It's very important that you confess your thoughts. Maybe you're being swayed and it's natural. Right? Maybe you're fearful. Maybe you're in that apathetic, I don't care kind of a situation. We need to stand as one. Next one. We need to, you know, worship. This is the most important of all. You know, this is, who is this? This is glory. This is glory. Look, when she tries to process all the evil that's happening in the world, her hair immediately turns gray. Because that's what the effect of, right? And yet she said, when I thought how to understand it, it was too painful for me. How the evil are winning, how the wicked are getting the upper hand, yet until I went into the sanctuary of God, then I understood their end. When you worship. Remember John the Apostle in the island of Patmos? The churches are under persecution. But what's the most important thing that God gave John the Apostle? He gave John the vision to share to the churches, I have not moved one bit from my throne. I am here. I have eyes that are like blazing fire. I have words that are like sharper than double-edged sword. My legs are like bronze, right? And his hair is like white as wool, full of wisdom. God knows. He is in charge. And you don't get to absorb that in your heart unless you spend time worshiping. That's why the worship today, the songs, are so empowering for me. I know that God is on the throne and I'm worshiping Him not alone, but with many. And lastly, brothers and sisters, pray for those who persecute you. You have heard that it was said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, that you may be children of your Father in heaven. You know, when you are insulted, assaulted, right? You will be angry. And then you will retaliate. But Jesus, when He suffered, He did not retaliate. He made no threats. It's not true for all of us, right? But that will happen if we stop seeing these people as lost and start praying for them. And then you say, oh, maybe the mercy of God will be displayed, that these very people are persecuting, like Paul is persecuting the church, will convert, and what a great testimony. You know, that's why it's not good to hate the transgender and the drag queens that were there. You know, maybe it's better. And one bishop actually said, maybe these are the kind of people who would be sitting at the dinner table with Jesus at that time. But of course, but not to accommodate, and like the adulterous woman, Jesus said, I don't judge, I don't condemn, but live your life of sin. But pray. Praying for them will soften your heart, and you will see the magnanimity of God. That is a God who has been merciful to you, and can give the same mercy to everyone else. And last one, be prepared with gentleness and respect. But in your hearts, revere Christ as Lord. Always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give the reason for the hope that you have. But do this with gentleness and respect. After you have worshipped, the Spirit will guide you. And no one can tell you what's wrong or what's right. You need to discuss this with people you trust. But pretty much when the Spirit tells you, post Malachi 2:16, who will question you? Right? If you already have worship and God says, encourage the single moms and tell them, God is your husband. Right? Maybe you will say, God is my husband, right? But when you have worship and the Holy Spirit has moved you, you are a free man. You are a free woman, right? But the key word I wanna touch here is be prepared. And preparation takes time. You cannot be prepared just because, God, I'm confronted, what do I do now? Preparation means you have prepared before. Get into the Word, discuss with people, examine your thoughts, and even if it's shameful, what you have accepted in your mind already, what you have accommodated. If fear has overtaken you and you have been quiet, although you could have illuminated someone's mind in the past and you were so politically correct, you can confess, right? And start the preparation time, because people will turn from bad to worse. But God is on the throne. He declares the end from the beginning. He is sovereign, and we sit with God on His throne as His children. Brothers and sisters, we have a sovereign God. How great is our God? And even these people who attack them, just like Paul attacked Christianity, who knows? The grace of God is huge. To God be the glory.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you, bro, for... Good evening. Massive awareness. It's a lot to process and to handle it. But in my personal opinion, alone, I'm speaking for myself, God used the Olympic as a medium platform to create global awareness. Let's remember that the attack started when we embrace Christ as our Savior and our provider. So it's just that everyone is in the Olympic right now, and it's all in the social media. So let's not remember our own single battle. Amen?
Amen.
To God be the glory. Thank you, bro, for a round of applause. Thank you so much. And thank you so much also for the our sound team there. Thank you so much. A round of applause, please. And thank you for our team ministry. And I would like to thank personally the KK teacher for looking after our kids. Thank you so much. I really appreciate that. Thank you, bro, Vince, for reminding us. Brother Andrew said that it's all about preparation. But Vince reminded us today that we have to have a hope and faith, and commit your way to the Lord, trust in Him. Right? And thank you, Glory and Robert. Recently, I lost my mom. I lost my mom recently, and because of my busy life, I was not able to go home. And it's truly a reminder that no matter how busy we are, we have to pause and remember that the work and whatever we are doing, it will not stop unless we pause. Amen? So let's go for the announcement. We are back in the Oval Hall at 1 p.m. on August 11. If you are visiting us today, thank you for coming, and please reach out with the person who reached out with you who invited you today. We have a Bible talk every Wednesday or Thursday in middle of the week. And the Kids Kingdom parents, please collect your kids as soon as this worship finish, and let's remember to thank the KKC teachers. Mighty Warriors group to start in September. It is a focus group to get trained. It will be in the third week every month after church in room 307 on this premises. Please let your Bible talk leaders know if you like to be part of it before the end of this month. Bible talk leaders meeting for August will be August 11 at 3:30 p.m. at 307 The Voice. Roland Monhe from Philippines will be doing midweek series from September 25th for 5 weeks on the Book of Revelation. So everyone's invited. Thank you. And to close this service, let's bow and pray. Our Father in Heaven, thank you for gathering us today and give us ourselves to be exactly where you want us to be today. To be fed by your words and testaments, reminded us to pause on whatever we are doing and look back and remember your sacrifice 1,000 years ago. And reminded us at the same time to trust you alone and have faith. As we depart in this place, Father, may you prepare our heart and remind to embrace the new week, challenges, and more importantly, welcome your blessings and guidance. I pray this in your Son, Jesus. Amen.
Amen. So for our last song, I'll be playing a video from our YouTube before. It's a song praises heard around the world. Now, I invite everyone to sing along, but the attempt here is not just for nostalgia, but really remembering God's faithfulness and goodness in during those days and up until now. Alright? So let's praise God. God is good. God is good. All the time. All right, praise God. Let's play this song.
Okay.
people there rejoicing with one voice. They are shouting, singing hallelujah. Praise the Lord around the world. All your creation, each and every
hallelujah, praise the Lord around the world.